In fact, what people talk about samadhi, in a very simple sense, when you understand, samadhi means peaceful. Mind is peaceful, mind is not wandering here and there. And then being in the peaceful state is what is called as samadhi. And that itself is something which is, you transcend the mind. Because mind is peaceful, you can transcend the mind. Then what you are is the self, the I. And this I is a very pure, absolute pure I. It's not any contaminated I. Why is that? Is that we have two different I's. One I is what we create because of our own culture, circumstances, training, and impressions, and all that thing. That makes this I. Not that they are bad. But then this function, these are all functional. That's why I said these are functional I. But then there's another I, which is supposed to be primitive I. That means it's not for the function sake, but it is the original that is there. That is the kind of thing. So that is what in the first chapter is, in the first, second or third sutra, is that vritti is the one which takes us out. When you remove all the vrittis, you become swarupa. Swarupa means yourself. But then what happens, the second, this is the second one that he brings about. But then the third sutra brings about a very interesting twist to that. He says that whatever that pure, untainted, unblemished kind of primitive I that is there, pure I that is there, somehow we get an impression that all outsides as I. So that means swarupa. Swarupa means my being. That's what my being is, a swarupa. But then I identify with the world outside. So whatever that is there in the form of vritti becomes like for example, I'm the very identification. I'm a human being. It is not true. Consciousness does not have it. So I'm a human being. That means I borrowed this concept. It's from the outside. I'm a man or a woman. It's again borrowed from outside. But by the way, I borrowed it. It was actually functional. It is not my original. So it's a functional part of it. But then for making it useful in our transaction, we take it. It becomes like we identify with that. There are four steps by which you identify with that. One is that I come associated with that. The second thing is I get habituated to that. And then third is that I try to identify with that. And fourth one is I become that. Like for example, anger. I become anger. I become myself anger. There is no between. I have anger. It's far away. I become angry. I become depressed. Like the way that those things happen, I become man. So these are the identification that we become identified with that. Vritti sarupya mitartha, that means to say what is supposed to be functional, become my own. Like, so, yeah.
The four stages, association?
First is the association, first one is the
fourth one was becoming.
Fourth one is becoming. And third one is basically the habituate. First one is the association, second is the habit, and third is the getting identified with that, and fourth one is to become that totally. Association becomes habit, habit becomes, in Sanskrit when we talk about it, association becomes like paricha, the second thing is like habit becomes, vasana, vasana becomes samskara, and samskara becomes, and in another, in bhakti language, when you talk about it, samipya, sayujya, sarupya, sakara, the four stages.
Vasana is habit and becomes samskara.
Habit becomes vasana, becomes samskara. The difference in a modern language, if you would like to take approximately, is that habit level, it has not interfered with our personality. at physiology level, it is not. I just would like to go because basically I'm attracted towards that. That's what is the habit. Given a choice, I would like to go for that. That's what is the habit. But then vasana is, it percolated my physiology, which means basically that my physiological function is affected by this. That's what is the vasana.
And then samskara is what you become.
Samskara is that it enters into genetic level. Your genetic level has been influenced. You know, very easy idea of equation that we take, parallel that we take it. So we say that, you know, the drunkards. There is a difference between a drinker and a drunkard. You just social drinking that you do it. But the next level is that where there's only one level that you give, but then this social living, drinking becomes much more stronger with us, that without drinking evening that you feel miserable because basically it entered into your physiology. And then drunkard is the one, if he doesn't drink, then salpa neer begaitu kudiyakke. And you become one with the drinking. Mullah Nasruddin tells his son, wants to train him how much he should drink, takes him to the pub and shows him the opposite table. You know, you are young, you don't know. I should teach you how much you drink. Opposite table, there are two people, and the moment you start seeing them as four, you should stop drinking. And then the son replies to dad, "Dad, there's only one person sitting there. Where are two people?" That means dad is already gone. So a habit becomes vasana. And from this point of view, when you take it, at the habit level, it has not become sickness. Habit level, it has not become sickness, it's habit. But whereas vasana level, it percolates into physiology. So therefore, hypertension is a vasana. See, ordinary, you know, just somebody is coming, you know, your BP goes up. Simple thing. You see something and BP goes up. It's just a habit. It's just an incidence. But then repeatedly happening becomes a habit. Then your BP fluctuates. But then when it becomes some vasana, that means it becomes hypertension as a sickness.
Can you relate this to Agis and Vyadis?
Yeah, exactly. See, it is now slowly Adhi is becoming Vyadhi. Vyadhi at a very soft level, Vyadhi at much deeper level. That's why Adhi, we say, Vyadhi, Adhi becoming Vyadhi, we say whether it is Vyadhi, is it at a very manageable level or much deeper level like that. At one point of time, Vyadhi is something that you don't have to give the medicine. You can manage with the only idea of yoga and other techniques. Okay? But when it becomes much more deeper, then we need to give some support from outside. Mani Mantra Aushadebhyam, that's what the texts say. I might give some medicines or some herbs and all that, to see that I can pull him up to some degree. After that, I give him these practices so that he comes out of it. So this is what the depth of these things that are there. Vyadhi depths.
So an addiction,
yeah,
is already operating at the level of samskaras.
Yes, addiction is working at the level of samskara, correct.
And this can carry over from one lifetime to the next.
Yes. That's why
deeper than DNA,
right?
So it's a feedback loop. The more you do it, the louder the sound becomes.
Yes. The more influencing you, the less it gives, you lose the freedom more and more. See, as you go deeper and deeper, you lose the freedom more and more. You are bound. That's why we call this as a freedom. Going to Vedanta philosophy is freedom. Not only these things, we can become addiction is still bad. We get habituated to food at the particular time, a kind of food. See, all these things also can become like a habit and then vasana in such a way that you are bound by that. You cannot tolerate anything other than that. For a person like me who goes about 50 countries, definitely, if I'm addicted to only a South Indian in food, how could I survive in the world outside? I should not get addicted to it. You know, my freedom. Once it so happened, you know, myself and Didi, Dr. Nagaratna, we all, my son, we went to Japan for some seminar. And then we wanted to go to Fuji Mountain. And then I said, halfway we'll have to have lunch, something like that. What do we carry for lunch? Nagaratna, she said, well, carry Japanese, we'll try Japanese food, vegetarian food. So, umeboshi. I said very clearly, please don't try that. So for me, I said, I want two times bread and butter, jam, nothing more than that. When we went there, they ate my butter and jam, I too ate umeboshi. I could eat it because basically I had not caught up in that. Can eat anything. But then I know that they just can't eat it. All those kind of things. So essentially the idea is that don't get habituated to anything. It's good or bad. Bad substances that which can easily drag you, catch you. Like why we say that it's all right that you tried LSD or you tried mushrooms or marijuana. These are the things where they try to catch you very fast. That means that you want to go back again and again to that kind of an experience.
Yeah.
So that is why they are bad. Otherwise, smoke is also bad. In fact, much more difficult to give up smoke than other things. I'm digressing the topic itself. So, but one very important idea is that, all right, you are taking the drug. That is not giving you the experience of samadhi. Samadhi is there within us. Only thing is it's helping you to remove the dirt or muck that is there on top of it, and you are in touch with your samadhi. So that is samadhana. See, samadhana means peaceful state. So that means there are degrees of peace within us. There are different degrees of peace. An ordinary peaceful state, like for example, you are peacefully sitting in your place, but at the same time you are restless inside. You can't be peaceful. You want to do something or the other, otherwise you are wasting your time. This restlessness also is an obstruction in your peace. Can you go to that state where you are peaceful, but at the same time you don't have any restlessness hanging on you? A very simple indication is that when you are peaceful and then you are restless, you look for some support or the other for you to engage yourself with. Some bird sound or some music or something or the other you would like to have. So that means that much of peace is still not yours. It's like the way that you take a towel and wring the towel to take out all the water that is there. Yeah, anything you do, not even one drop of water does not come out of it. But does not mean that the towel is dry. It has got wetness. So we have even in our mind these disturbances which are loosely hanging around. See, why I said loosely is that they don't have any proper particular idea. Like you are caught up with some issue. Then there is a particular idea, particular thread, and your thoughts are gathered of that, around that. Anything will go towards that. But these are the things where they're loosely hanging. They don't have any particular. They just come and go, and like you are sitting here, something like that, you have nothing to do. Suddenly you think about something which happened about 3 years ago, 5 years ago. So, that person I did not meet after so many years. Maybe I'll meet one time. Like that, there is some thought which is unconnected, just comes and makes it you. So this is the loosely hanging kind of thought that are there, but otherwise you are peaceful. The second level of peace is that level where none of these thoughts are haggling, but then any thought comes, you feel disturbed by that. A thought comes, you feel disturbed by that. That means to say that peace is not really true peace, but that's a peace that is brought about on you. Ah, see, it's how I wanted to avoid all the city and then came to Prashanti. I'm peaceful here, but suddenly here also I get some vehicle sound. See, that means you are trying to avoid that. That outside sound is trying to create a disturbance to you. The world is disturbing you. So that means to say retention is there outside, but then you are peaceful. That's what is prajna. Attention is outside, your prajna is outside, but you are peaceful behind that. This is what is called as samprajnata. That means I am peaceful inside, I am in a samadhi, but at the same time, the outside stimulus, I still respond to it. I still cognize that my prajna is there with outside. That is the samprajnata samadhi, first level samadhi. So in samprajnata, that means to say some sound comes, some stimulus happens, and then I am associated with that. Some smell comes from the kitchen. Immediately, oh, so today something is being made. My mind also thinks about it. Thought came because of some stimulus. Otherwise, thought is not there in the mind. I'm peacefully sitting. We are all having that state of mind within us, a peaceful state with some little association with the world outside. That's also a very profound state of peace. It's not an ordinary peaceful state. Ordinary peaceful state is chattering mind is there, but that is not there. But this one is there. Stimulus response is still there in mind. This is what is samprajnata samadhi. From that, when we go further deep, that is what the stimulus is not there, is not impacting on me, but I am still there in the peaceful state. So this is what is asamprajnata. That means I don't have any prajna outside. But there also, if you go closer, then there are two different levels. One level is that a stimulus is there, but then, you know, any stimulus, it has to first go into the brain and then create a mark there. And then it will come out in the form of response from you or perception from you. There is a center where the stimulus is there, and then it goes to report to you saying that, yes, something is pricking me. This is a very common test that we also do it. Like, for example, we give a pin prick to the body and you cognize that. Did you feel that? And then immediately say, yeah, I found it. That you put it on the, you know, ECG machine, that is not ECG, EEG, electrograph. And then you can see that there is brain waves are going on. Suddenly there is a kick comes into the brain wave, a sound kick comes into the wave. So that means that exactly the precise second where there is a stimulus given to you. Like, for example, generally this stimulus that they give is audio stimulus that you put on the, and then suddenly beep, beep, beep comes, then you say, yeah. And then you can see also on that biofeedback machine also shows that. You see that there is a peak in that, there's a beat in that. So that means you are cognizing the sound outside, that is samprajnata, but then you are peaceful inside. In fact, there's a very interesting thing. Is it coming from, how is it transmitted within us? It is a consciousness which transmits within us. See, stimulus, and then from stimulus, like for example, my hand is there, it has to travel all the way. What is that medium through which it travels? Let's say it's consciousness. You are conscious about that. That's what even the people who are in the coma state, that you test them and then see that they're. Now we have done another very interesting thing, and that is, we are connected consciously, that the consciousness level we are connected. That means to say, I get a pain, and then you also feel pain. Oh, what happened to Raghuram? Why is pain? Actually, it's not that you are just saying it, but you are feeling it. That means consciousness is a communication system within us. It doesn't require any medium outside. So we just wanted to do some study on that. And it is not even electrical signal. It is something which is beyond electrical signal. That's what is the consciousness. So therefore, there are two persons who are very close, very easily responding to each other, understanding very well. We separate them into two different chambers. And these are the Faraday chambers. Faraday chamber means there is no electricity goes. And then we give stimulus to one person. And then you see the recording of the other person, you see the response there. That means in his brain wave, you could see that prick has come. How did it come is they're not physically connected. But then this response was something happens. This is becoming a little more deeper. You say, yeah, I think my friend is in trouble. I should go and help him. Many times you feel that. That's the connection, consciousness connection that we have. So further deep, I mean, if it is not the electrical signal, it's not this thing, though we put in the electric chambers and all that. But we thought we should do, separated them so far away so that you could see that they, whether they respond to it or not. There is one experiment that was done in California. You know, what the thought carried to the, it's not even said or something like that, it is a thought which is carried to the other person, consciousness. There's one lady, she's a single lady, and she has a dog at home, a huge dog. And she goes, you know, Los Angeles is a place of distances. It takes about 2 hours, 1.5 hours to come back from the work. So she is working there in the office. They had cameras both at home and at office. And then the moment she leaves for office, the dog will go and sit at the place that is assigned for her, for him. And the moment she has a thought saying that, okay, now let me go home, you know, evening. Program is over, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, let me go home. In a typical moment, you can see on the camera what is the way that woman responds when she wants to go home. First thing is that she opens the drawers and then takes out the vanity bag and then goes into the bathroom and then dresses up herself and comes back and then, you know, shoves all the drawers and all that. So that very thought in her came. At that precise time, the dog gets up from his place and comes to the front door. It still takes about 1 hour, 1.5 hours, but then the dog is waiting there now standing. How did the dog know that she's about to start? It is not at exactly the same time. One day it is 6 o'clock, one day it is 5 o'clock, one day something like that. So she would go. The dog would come and stand there. This is what is the experience. One day it so happened that she planned to go and then the dog came and stood. While coming, suddenly this lady must have thought, I should meet some friend and then go. She took a turn, goes to some friend's place. Dog went back and sat down. Exactly. Again, from that house that she started, probably that is the thing, because now that CCTV camera is not there. So the dog came and stood. That means basically now she once again planned to come to home. So how much consciousness communicates? So we wanted to now. This consciousness, see, if it is supposed to be not matter, consciousness, then it should violate the matter's laws. Electrical signals, that they have light speed is there. So can the signal go beyond the speed of light? This is what we wanted to try. So how can we do it? We have two people across the globe. Somebody is in India and somebody is in Mexico. This actually happened with the University of Mexico. So then what happens, this light to travel from there to here, signal of light or electricity, it takes some nanoseconds gap. So we wanted to actually make all the arrangement to see that. We tracked that. And then we had two persons also, they identify each other and put them in California. We tried that experiment and then they could relate. And then we tried to see that the one person is here, another person is there in Mexico University. All that project was planned and everything. Meanwhile, something happened in Mexico, some political this thing. The whole thing was abandoned. But our idea was to see that we would like to do that kind of an experiment. See, that means what is that your consciousness is all about, how deep it is. That's what is a pure self-view. Your you. It's nothing to do with the gender, with all the other impressions that are there outside. So go beyond that level. So now, so first, this experiment itself, when we see that a stimulus and response in Germany hospital that we did it, I give a stimulus and I see the stimulus that I give, maybe in the form of a prick, I can see in that brain picture exactly that moment where that signal is there, and then you get it. Signal is there, but that person says that I did not get it. No, there was no stimulus. That means to say he is now gone to that state of peace of mind where the signal is shown in the brain, but it did not reach him. The brain center where the signal is supposed to go, goes, but from there to the person, it did not go. Then the next level, we have seen the person is so peaceful that you exactly give the same kind of stimulus, brain does not receive it. That means it travels nervous system up to the brain, but the brain does not receive it. Probably somewhere in between, it just cut off and then you are freed from that. You didn't even, brain did not even show that there is a stimulus. This is what is asamprajnata. That means your prajna has been cut off completely from the world outside. You are inside. Now, once you have gone inside, then there are different layers. You can go further silence and silence and say, these are the different stages of samadhi. This is what he calls it as ananta samapatti. That means to say, it's not an ordinary silence. It's a very deep, unending silence. And then it just like pours on you. It's poured. Because basically you cannot do it. It has to happen to you. It's like you enter into a black hole kind of a thing. So therefore, and there are four levels that are there. One level is that where it says Savitarka, Savichara, Ananda, Asmita, Anugamat. It says that all these four stages you cross. What are the four stages? You are peaceful, you are silent, and you are not disturbed by the world outside. All those things are there. But at the same time, your logic is still there. Your rational is there. Good and bad, right and wrong. I like this, I don't like this. This is I accept this, I don't accept. This pairs of opposite is actually in our intellect.
Vijnanamaya
question. Right. So at that level, we are still there. That means that it's very clear, very strong, and we don't go beyond that. We can't go beyond that. Everything gets stuck there, and that's all. Final is that. This is right, this is wrong. Right and wrong. That means this pairs of opposite is very concrete. But then there is another level of peace of mind that's there within us where you go beyond this savitarka. That means, for example, for that is, I always try to give that. If some child is sitting with you and then doing some math, and then he says that 2 multiplied by 2 is 5, 5 plus 5 is 15, 15 plus 5 is 26. You're boiling inside. You can't accept it. And hey, you can be peaceful. Nothing to do with you. Whatever he's doing, he's doing. Don't get caught up in that. No, you can't sit quiet. Too much it is. Your BP is going up. That means basically you are still caught up in tarka. You can't go beyond tarka. So this tarka is a very wonderful tool. It's a very important tool. In fact, without the knowledge of, without this discrimination or without this judging, we won't be living in this world. So it's a very important tool. In fact, highest tool that we have in this world is the intellect, logic. All this technology development, all because of the intellect only that we have seen. But in the silence of mind, that is the lowest level. He says, go beyond that. Yeah, something happens, I'm just okay, fine. So this is what is the level where And this there within you. Only thing is that you don't have courage to go to that level. You are caught up in that. You're not courageous to go beyond the level of this logic. That's why when people get caught up in that, tell me how it happens. Tell me why it happens like that. See, because you are restless there. But then there is one level where it says you come out of vitarka, savitarka to nirvitarka. So that's the transition. That means you cross beyond the level of logic. Life is peaceful. Logic is an extraordinary, wonderful tool. It's a very, very sharp, fine knife. So when it's very fine, sharp knife, you should be careful where you should use it, where you should not use it. It cuts you. It cuts anything. That's what is the problem with that. So is there a way that I can go to a level where I use it when it is necessary, but I can leave it behind and then go ahead? Sharper the truth, greater is the danger. A sharp intellect is more difficult for that way to overcome. But when we go beyond that, this is what is savitarka. This one level to nirvitarka, that you just cross that boundary of logic. Once you go beyond, in fact, there also there are so many things that are there, 3-4 different things. You see, what happens is we get caught up in the logic. Now, logic is supposed to explain to you the science or philosophy behind it. But then, that logic itself will prevent you from going to the science and logic, science and the knowledge. See, if you look at it, people get into the intellectual argument to find out the intellect truth. But then they get caught up in the argument so much that they don't want to go to the truth. They don't accept the truth. Because now slowly what happens, it does not become logic, it becomes my logic. People, great people, they get caught up in that. Like, for example, the story of Einstein and Schrodinger. Schrodinger did the black cat experiment, and then he proved to Einstein that, he disproved some Einstein theory. And then there is no logic. There is no reason why that is wrong. So Schrodinger presented that to Einstein. Schrodinger went through the whole thing and then finally said, it's nice, good, publish it after I die. Because I'm caught up with my thought. I don't want it to be dismissed. So that means it slowly becomes his attachment. Now there is no more higher truth than that. He can't accept it. Church also did like that. Church said, Earth is born on 4004 BC. On a Friday evening at 4 o'clock or something like that, they said. But in the Genesis, it is there. Then, you know that this fellow, Stephen Hawking is looking at all this, black hole and Earth is born, birth of the Earth. And that's what is the recent experiments also they were doing. When Stephen Hawking, he was in Rome to attend one of the science congresses where he was, people made a announcement that he's somebody who has given us the idea that so many billions of years back that this black hole idea, all that was there, how the creation has taken place. Pope called him to Vatican from Rome. And then in a meeting, Pope said that you don't have to look at the experiment in the lab about the origin of universe, because the church has already given, Bible has already given 4004 BC, and Friday evening at 4 o'clock, Earth is created after big floods and all that. So therefore, and then Stephen Hawking writes in his book, The Brief History of Time, he says, this is what happened between me and Pope. And he laughed. He said, science has progressed so much after that. And still, church is holding on to it. It was such a sad thing. Same Pope. He came to Pope Paul. He came to Colorado. I was there at that time, Colorado. And then he gave a statement saying that after all, Galileo said that the Earth is going around the sun. He's right. Church is wrong. 2002, he made that statement. I mean, when was Galileo and when?
So, Amending the past.
Yeah. You see, slowly what happens, this is what happens with the tarka. If you are really not careful, tarka means basically it's the logic. Logic tries to help the science to grow, but then you get attached to the logic so that you don't allow the science to grow. What is supposed to give you the growth is supposed to be the one which comes in the way. And that's what, you know, Manudharma Shastra said several years ago in India, dharma eva hato hantihi tasmad dharma. Therefore, basically you say, dharmo rakshati rakshitaha, tasmad dharmo nahantavyaha, nako dharmo hato vadit. There also exists that people who seem to be taking care of the logic and knowledge are the people, be careful with them because they kill the knowledge. Dharma eva hato hantihi. From that, the second, dharmo rakshati rakshitaha. You always hold on to dharma. That's what the idea said. And that second portion, dharmo rakshati rakshitaha, everybody uses all over the world. Every Indian knows about that. But you ask them, what is the full sutra behind it? Many people do not know. They know only that small little portion of it. Dharmo rakshati rakshitaha. The front portion, the later portion there. There also they cut it and take it what is useful for. So anyway, therefore basically there is a stage where you are peaceful, leave the logic behind it. Don't get into the logic, don't get into the clutches of the logic. Go beyond that. This is what is Nirvitarka Samadhi. That state of mind is there. But then what happens is, even though when we go there is a level where it is, thoughts are still there. You may be very peaceful, but a thought still hangs around. Thought is still working around. Like for example, I see somebody, my thought is there about that particular person. My idea about that particular person. So therefore, this thought is still there behind me. A thought is called as, in a sense, vichara. That means to say, you know, vichara is a very beautiful word. Normally, as I said, that our mind can scatter, suddenly it catches up anything and then goes anywhere. That's what I said, that organized thought to disorganized thought, that is there, thought is there. Mind going that way is called as chara. And then vichara is, it goes in a particular path which is you assign to it. So your mind always has what is called as a thought, that means mind goes in a particular orderly direction. It just goes. Like for example, I see a person, immediately the stimulus comes in that way. Oh, I've seen him sometime back and now he has come back again. Maybe he wanted to meet me or something like that. And then he comes in front of you and then goes without even meeting you. What? He doesn't even meet me? He doesn't even recognize me? Then he says, who are you? Are you? Not only doesn't he recognize me, he asks me, who are you? We are in a bad shape now. No, we met one month ago. Oh, you met my cousin brother. Twin brother. Finish. My twin brother. We both look alike, so therefore you must take. So that means, you see, all this conversation shows you have a mind, so particular pattern, it just goes. Vichara. So, and you are in that particular pattern of thinking mind, vichara. And many times this vichara, that is the thought process, is given by somebody, or maybe for some time back, maybe somewhere else. So this vichara is taking you away from the presence, today, now, this moment. So there is a stage of samadhi, or peaceful state of mind, where you are not in sama, in vichara, you are free from the vichara. Savichara, to deeper than that, is called as Nirvichara Samadhi. Nirvichara, Nairantarya, etc., etc. I use a big explanation. I mean, I just wonder what must be extraordinary brain of this fellow, Patanjali, could think of all these intricacies at that time, 2000 years ago. But then what happens is that Vichara is also gone. That means, you see, Vichara is always dead. And this process is actually going beyond the level of thought to thinking. Normally, we don't see the difference between thought and thinking. But thought is solidified. Thought is patterned already. Thought is something which is prefixed. Thought is dead and gone. It does not come back again. Whereas thinking is being in the present. Thinking is now. Thinking is here. Thinking is in front of you. So thinking makes you lively. Thought will not make you lively. That's why when we say in yoga that you silence the thoughts, basically means be in the present. Don't make it into the past. That is the idea. So somebody who really, these are all there, and then with the practice that when we are able to reach that state, such a person is vibrant in thinking, but he does not get into the caught up, he doesn't get caught up in the idea of thought process. So the thinking to thought, in fact, there's, J. Krishnamurti, J.K., one of his disciples, his students, was U.G., Uppalur Gopal Krishnamurti. He's also U.G. and Andhra. He used to be in Bangalore. He was a mystic saint like J.K. He was also like that. He used to be with us very casually and ideas. He gave one beautiful idea. He said that, in the space already that there are thoughts, and we just pick up one thought and work and send it. What is mind? Mind is an instrument which can just pick up with this thought and then work and then send it. It's all a beautiful expression that is. Thought doesn't belong to you. You always claim that a thought belongs to you. No. Thought never belongs to you. Just pick up some thought in this space, use it and then throw it. Just like you just breathe in some air inside and then throw it out once it is gone. Isn't it? How much similarity it is there? You have a system to receive the air and then throw it out. Like that, you have a system to receive the thought and then throw it. Why do you get caught up in the thought then? So therefore it says, savichara to nirvichara. That means to say, going from the thought to thinking process. It's a big journey. It's a huge leap that you need to make it. Otherwise, it's so easy we get caught up in that. But then he says that can you go beyond the level of thinking also? Thought to thinking we can go. But he says that can you go beyond the thinking? All these things are for the sake of one simple experience called as ananda, happy. I'm happy now. I'm joyful now. So this is what is the ananda. Ananda is the blissful state, happy state. Even when you go to sleep, you are happy there. If there is no happiness, we would get up from the sleep. If you are sleeping, and there is some reason or the other that your happiness is not there in the sleep, you wake up. Maybe some sound is there, maybe something is there. Suddenly temperature goes down, sleep started feeling cold. Or maybe some too many mosquitoes around you. So all those things wake you up. That means to say, you look at all these things are leading you to that happiness, ananda. So I am constantly with the sense of ananda is one state of peace. I am peaceful, but at the same time I am happy. I am happy. This is what is the state of happiness. Ananda is at that level.
Like children.
Like?
Like children.
Like children, yes, like children. All blissful, happy.
Before they start thinking, before they start claiming.
Thoughts. Yes, they don't have this idea of mind, possession, nothing is that. They're just happy. They're just happy. So that's what is the state of ananda. But then Patanjali says that can you go beyond the level of ananda? That's why savitarka, savichara, sa ananda, anugama. That means to beyond that. Beyond that, what is there? That is where basically there is ego. Ego, and which is, he calls it as asmita. So, vichara, ananda, asmita, these four stages, anugamat. That means so beyond that. Cross that, transcend that.
Beyond ananda.
Beyond ego. Asmita. Asmita is supposed to be a good ego, but then it is still not that pure ego. Asmita is basically, there are three different aspects of Asmita. Asmita is useful ego. It's not pure ego, but it is useful ego. What is useful ego? What is useless ego? There are three types of useful ego that is there at Asmita. One is that the doer ego, like for example, you are sitting and meditating. Who is doing meditation? I'm meditating. That I want to meditate as the one, it's a doer ego. The second thing is identifier ego. I identify myself. I'm so and so, I'm this, I'm that. All those identification. First of all, great identification is I'm human being. And later on the other things come. Identification, that I'm an Indian, I'm a Hindu, you know, all these things are there. These are all different identifications. And associated with that identification, that so many things that are also built around it. Like for example, once I was in, how subtly it would be there, very peaceful early morning in Frankfurt airport, I was just walking all alone, I was going. Suddenly I hear some sound from some small kiosk was there, and from there some music was coming. And the moment I heard that music, naturally I'm pulled towards that because it is one of the good Indian music. There is an artist by name Jagjit Singh. People are fond of his. I'm also fond of his music. So the moment I heard from the kiosk, Jagjit Singh Ghazal, I just started walking towards that unconsciously. And then from there, because it's not yet open, dark and all that, and somebody was there saying, in Hindi, he said, Bhai Saab, my dear brother, please come, sit down. Wow. So Indian. You see, I'm Indian, my identification with another Indian. This identification is very important. This is Jnatrutva, that means identify. And then naturally, you know, he asked, Saab, do you like Jagjit Singh? I said, yes. I said, are you coming from Bombay? Because people in Bombay, that North India, that they like that. Generally, in South India, people do not, are not familiar with Jagjit Singh, I should say. So then I said, no, I'm not from Bombay. I'm from Bangalore. Then he said, ah, Bangalore also people listen to Jagjit Singh. Very nice, he said. I asked him, which part of India are you coming from? Which part of India? He said, no, sir, I'm from Pakistan. The moment you are here that he's from Pakistan, you become very defensive. Because Pakistan is another neighboring country. But then he said, next word, very beautiful, he said, sir, what is this India and Pakistan? It's all these politicians made. Otherwise, we eat the same kind of vegetable, we say, we eat same kind of food, we listen to same kind of music. I wish that we just become one. How beautiful it is. So anyway, your flight is still to start. Why don't you sit down here? Because I like your company. Because, you know, from I feel so. See, identification is so important. And then afterwards, then I went. Like that, we have an identification. This there. Various levels of identification that way. So it is very important. I'm a man, I'm a woman. This is what is our ego that we built. Very good. The doer ego, and then identifier ego, and then third one is the experiencer ego. I cannot deny that experience. I experienced my, say, pain in my leg. I report saying that, yeah, I have pain in my leg. No, no, you can't have pain in the leg. Nobody can say that. I have pain in the leg. I cannot deny myself. Huh, there may be a fracture, that's why I have pain in the leg. He can say, no, there is no fracture, but it may be some other thing. The cause for the experience, he might deny. Experience, he cannot deny. See, you have to make these two things clear. The reason for an experience is what? People immediately jump into conclusion. No, leave it. Can we separate that out? If you really can see that you are peaceful state of mind and the ego, which has an experiencer ego, you can see that you can separate this out. I have an experience, like for example, something, food item, I don't like it. People come from the west here to Prashanti, Prashanti food, hot in the beginning. And then our kitchen people say, no, 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 it is not hot, it is Satvik food. I don't know. My experience, you don't deny it. Experiencer ego. Experiencer ego saves you. It is saving you all the time. Consciously, unconsciously, everything. So these three egos are there. One is the identifier ego, experience ego, third is the doer ego. All these three belongs to Asmita. That's a good ego. But then when this good ego becomes bad ego, without even our knowledge, thinking that I got caught up in these things, I did it. Your doer ego is fine. But then for everything, you might not have done anything. Because of me, things happened. If I were not to be there, it would have been real chaos. Why do you identify with that doer ego so much? This is what becomes your ego, which is painful for you. You don't realize that. Good ego is never painful to you, but bad ego becomes painful to you. Identify with the object, identify with the ideas. This is my idea. People say that, you know, they ask something and then, oh, I already knew it. What's the point in telling that? I already knew it. That ego wants to preserve that idea that I knew it before you told me. Many times people come and, you know, particularly mothers come and tell the, I mean, not about you plus. Are they going to say that, you know, tell my boy something. So I tell the boy. Oh, these are nice things. Mother says, I already told him, but you know, when you say it makes sense. Arre, why do you have to say, I already told him? He doesn't listen to you. Finish, God. But that what I said, I get ego about that. I am saying that. Asmita is something which is good ego, but you cross that Asmita. Then you are the self. Vitarka, vichara, ananda, asmita, anugamat. You need to cross that. Then becomes swarupa. Then such a state is something which is no difference between that state and Brahman. You become one with the Brahman. But then why are you there in this body? As long as this body continues, because it has certain fuel in that, it continues. So long that time, this body is there. But when this body, such a person loses this body, and during that time, when he is in this body, with this kind of an understanding, he says, in the Deha. Deha means body. Deha means actually just the temple. So he is in the temple. But the moment he leaves his body, and then as long as he is just only having that ego, he says, Videha Prakriti Layanam. That means to say all that he just merges into the Prakriti. That means the nature is there. But then he still did not get the freedom until he crosses that. Such a person will get into final samadhi. That is what it is. No vikalpa, nirvikalpa samadhi. That is the state one reaches. That ultimate nirvikalpa samadhi is something which is such a person who can reach there is a person who can see. Just I am now merging into the consciousness. So prepare everything for that, showing that now I have nothing to do with anything. I'm prepared, now I'm going. Such a person knows the exact details of the death. So that's why I say that he is somebody who knows he knows his death. I'm going. Consciously goes into that. So,
Swami Vivekananda.
Vivekananda, yes. He just entered into death as if, oh, why? Like our teacher also. Happy, healthy, and all that, and suddenly he was to take him to be some test is already 81, 82 years. He said, ah, I did whatever that I'm supposed to do. So previous days, and because that he has to go for, a lot of people were coming and visiting him. So many visitors were there. So we don't want visitors to come. So tomorrow, let's not allow anybody to come. It's okay, he said. But then he said, Raghu, it doesn't apply to you. I want you to come here. I don't know why he said that. So I went in the morning, I sat there. Evening, Nagaratna came. And probably was waiting for her to come after she came. And then everybody was there. He said, okay, bye-bye, I'm taking leave. Because where are you going? Yeah, my work is done, I'm going now. As if he's, you know, taking leave. No, you're still okay. And then I said, no, you're fine, we'll go home. No, Raghu, you wait. And Ratna, you wait. And all others, he took leave off. And I said, okay, you both come, we go together. And went to the hospital to see that he is taken inside for ICU, for some test to be done and all that. While going to the finally, then ICU, and then we have to come out. That time I said, okay, Raghu, take care of everything. Ratna, I'm not coming back. He knew very well. In 2 hours, he's already gone. This is what is that place where those people, they merge into the... See, the others, they merge into the Prakriti Layana. They merge into the creative world. But then these are the people that they go beyond the thing where there is no vikalpa, there is no coming back. That's why nirvikalpa sthiti. There's one story about one Buddhistic monk. He was there in Belgaum. There is a Buddhistic settlement that is there. All this Tibetan Buddhistic settlement. And then there was one Rinpoche. He was there. The news came that he is going to die in 10 days. But he wants to enter into samadhi. And then slowly he goes through all these stages. Finally, after the 10 days, he will leave the body. But 10 days he will be there in this body. Oh, no, this is not right, this is not correct, we should not encourage that. Like that, people are making noise. But then suddenly he went into that quiet state, he was lying down maybe, something like that. 10 days he was still there. And then afterwards he just receded. And from here, some of our researchers went there, but then they said, don't do any research on him, but just you want to observe, observe him. So then what is that we can do by observing is, one thing is that 10 days there is absolutely no nothing, he was just lying down. But 10 days he was still looking very fresh. And then after the 10th day, suddenly the body started decaying, like the way a dead person's body decays. That was given an indication that 10 days he is still alive, but in a samadhi, deep samadhi state. Afterwards he left this body. It happened very recently, about 2000 or something like that. So these are the different levels of samadhi. Samadhana say beyond that, that you are pure consciousness. And all these, in the fourth chapter, he gives this idea also that in order to go to that experience, you can use the drugs and mushrooms and this and that. He talks about it. Samadhi, apart from that, all these other things also take you to that stage.
Then you can't stay there.
Ah, you can stay there, right. You can't stay there. You can't stay there because the simple reason is that as long as that influence is there, you are in that state. But the moment influence goes away, the most important thing is the fear comes up. This is what in one of the texts that is published, it has been explained, that what is supposed to be a state of fearlessness, and we are afraid of that state. The very state's name, the very experience name is supposed to be fearlessness. And then that creates a fear in you.
Why?
Because basically that we are not used to that state where, which does not undergo death. See, we are not in touch with that. That is there within us, but we are never consciously in touch with that. We never like consciously entered into that. So therefore, that's what is abhaye bhayadarshinaha. The state which is supposed to be freedom from fear, we are afraid of that state, we come back. Because we are happy with this particular state.
Okay. or habituated to it anyway.
Yeah. Anyway. So these are the different stages of samadhi, samadhana, that is what we're talking about. And tanmatras. You see, like for example, there's a very, eyes are there to see, ears are there to hear. This is what is the way that we look at the world. Look at the world is that eyes are there so that you see, ears are there so that you hear. Actually, the way when you look at consciousness, closer to consciousness is the process called seeing. You look at, you just because that your eyes, I can't say that you are conscious. You're able to see, then you say consciousness, isn't it? So what is closer to consciousness? Is it your eyes or is it your process of seeing? A process of seeing, process of hearing. That's why we say that, you know, we shout at him. Oh, get up, come on, open your eyes. And he hears, then you say, yeah, he is conscious. That is consciousness process is that. In fact, it is not even the consciousness. Consciousness itself becomes like hearing. Consciousness becomes like seeing. Consciousness becomes like touching, smelling, and all those things. And that brings about the sensory organs. The sensory perception is the one which gives rise to sensory organ. Wanting to see is the one which created the eyes. Wanting to hear is the one which created the ears. So therefore, when you look back at this, eyes and eyes tanmatra, that means its original is supposed to be seeing. Ears are there and its original is supposed to be hearing. So therefore, this is what is this sensory organ and its original is supposed to be the process. So that's why Upanishad says, just don't close your eyes and ears, etc., etc. Stop seeing, stop hearing. That is what we need to do. It's very important because basically it's not just going to stop seeing and stop hearing and all that. But if you look at very closely, not only that you see it, the tanmatra that is there, and it's mounted on that is your preferences, all those things mount on that. Even your eyes do not have any problem of whether you want to see it or not. But then there is tanmatra which says that, oh, I continue to see, again and again I see it. But then what happens? People don't realize that that is the problem there. They try to punish the sensory organ. My eyes are there, therefore my eyes go behind the beautiful girls. So I pluck my eyes. There are people who have done that. My body is there, that's why it wants to go towards the enjoyment. Therefore punish the body. This is what the Christian missionaries that they have, the people who torture themselves, their groups. And in India also, that there are people who torture themselves, go through all kinds of torture, thinking that it is the body which is responsible, but not the tanmatra, not the subtle aspect of it, which is the original aspect. Sometimes people will blame the object outside, saying that, you know, we have in our culture, the people who do the fasting on 11th day of the moon, Ekadashi, and also they do fasting once in a week or something like that. And they're very strict rule, in fact, and also when they go visit to some big pilgrim centers and all that, they give up something or the other to eat. They are supposed to give up fruit. So give up, you know, this custard apple. That's one thing they give up, something like that. And then in one house, I said, I was visiting somebody's house. I just said, casually, let me take the custard apple, because that Bangalore has a wonderful custard apple, a lot of them, nice bag of custard apple. They said, why did you bring this? I said, why are you asking? You know, going with a fruit is something which is very important, so I took the fruit. No, My father gave up the custard apple when he visited Kashi. Ever since that time in our house, we don't get custard apple. Poor fellow. He left it, and because of that, all seven children, everybody should not eat custard apple in the house. Why don't you bring it? So that means you blame the custard apple. Forget about your eyes, forget about your taste buds and all that. The objective world outside is blamed. Banana is there. You don't eat banana. Is it? Come on, can I have banana? I hate banana. Arre, poor banana did not do anything. It is just sitting on the table and then you hate it. If somebody does something, what will you do? Murder. You go to the outside. Tanmatra is recognizing that I have this consciousness which has the modification in the form of your perceptions, and that you give it up. Tanmatra. Really hard.
So, is it true that all five senses are one sense before they branch?
Yes. All senses, the central, that's what is the central unit of all those five senses is mind. Mind operates through these senses. And sensory inputs make the mind. You think of anything, activity of the mind, without any of the sensory inputs, then nothing.
So this explains synesthesia.
Yes, right, anesthesia. You are cut off from those experiences and the mind is peaceful. Sometimes when the anesthesia dose is more than, I've come across this thing, what is necessary for the sake of some surgery or something like that. And then they gave anesthesia and then surgery is over. And then he came up. But then that proportion, that sensory says, anesthesia proportion is such a way that he came to consciousness, but at the same time, still some degree of anesthesia was there. And that is the experience where he is fully awake, but absolutely no limits at all anywhere. It's like the way that, you know, your pupil dilator that they put when somebody's eyes are to be tested. And there is no constriction, so you see everything. Headlight comes, it's like a sun, it looks like, big. So like that, when anesthesia effect is still there, but at the same time you woke up, that is the experience of Brahman. That's similar to the experience of all this peyote or marijuana and all that. I mean, have you tested anything like that? What he explained? He had that
experience. I've tried plants.
Plants.
I'm from South America.
Oh yeah.
They use
this plant.
But I tried it I did it as a yogic experiment.
Actually, yeah. One who does not do that, does not try that, doesn't understand what the experience is. You must try that. In the classroom I can't say that. It just blows you out completely. All the what are supposed to be the boundaries that are there are completely broken. Wonderful experience. That experience only gives us in fact, there also in Carlo Castaneda, he uses that only to show that these states are available within you. Carlo.
I wrote a post about it. I'll send it to both of you. So my experience from the yogic perspective.
Right.
And comes into the conclusion of, okay, we don't need this.
Castaneda said the same thing eventually.
Yeah.
It was unnecessary. The power plants were unnecessary.
Yeah.
But you don't know that until you go there and find out.
Right. And people can tell you these things, but you still have to experience. Not everybody, but people like to experience. And they're considered also as medicine. So if you're not sick, what do you take?
Ah, right.
But it's not like, I might have a headache, so I take an aspirin.
Nah.
Most of us are sick with ego.
That's how I felt.
Sick with ego. Sick with ego. That is one thing which we need to.
I didn't say anesthesia. I said
Synesthesia. Okay. Synesthesia.
That's where one sense crosses over to another.
One sense crosses over to the. Yeah, it's a, there are then. I think in Shakespeare's sonnet, one of the expressions that are there. I don't remember exact words and all. I think it's Shelley's "Gather a Rosebud" or something like that, where he says that you, when you start hearing through your eyes, and when the eyes make you to hear the beautiful song, something like that expression he gives. And, the same kind of an expression is given in Indian text also, poetry, where he says that, and that's supposed to be bhakti. In bhakti explanation, when he says that, that is the moment where you hear, you hear the nice, wonderful smell, something like that, they're there. So that means that's what is crossing the senses. So this is the structure. See, the structure of the mind is this. Mind is connecting with all the senses. It's like a central unit which connects all the senses. Beyond the mind is your intellect, because the intellect has information going from the mind and going from memory and all those things, and then it tries to judge at that memory level. Beyond all these things is that the pure ego of yours, who has the idea of feeling, hearing and all those things, pure experience. There the feeling is there. So that's how I say that, which normally people do not agree with that, but then I feel that way, is that feeling of love, feeling of compassion, they come from that level, which is only, beyond that is only the God consciousness, divinity. So consciousness, pure divinity, becomes like compassion, etc., etc. And from then onwards, that intellect comes, verifies this, and then comes the mind and then sensory organ. And senses afterwards is the object outside, or beyond the senses or the object outside. So that's one of the reasons why you say that you feel it's wonderful, but when you want to execute, because the intellect belongs to the world outside, so use the intellect to execute the world outside. Feeling is different. That's why feeling belongs to self, expression belongs to the world outside.
Feeling belongs to self, expression belongs to
the world. Belongs to intellect. Feeling belongs to self.
That's why you should never argue with a fool, right?
Yeah. Yeah, argue with the fool. Save your argument.
But we're all fools.
People will not know the difference between you and the fool if you argue with the fool.